Hoe gaan het daar?
Heel gelukkig, man.
Heel lekker, man.
Dank je voor die broodje.
Ja, precies. How was the steak? Do you enjoy it?
This was awesome.
Yes.
I was feeling quite muff before I arrived, and now it's nice.
Now you're feeling lekker.
Yeah.
Well, there we go, bro. That's what we do.
Drinking a thing.
Sometimes all you need is a bit of food from your chums, you know? A bit of soul food.
Yeah.
Hello, Lizita. Yeah. Hello, Maloney. We're going to Mayela. Thanks for tuning in. This is going to be a reverse interview tonight. Theo has come with a bunch of questions for me, which we only can hope are kosher. But I just thought if we are going to do this, we may as well do it live. So why not? Thank you for pulling in.
Yay.
Right.
There's people just joining scenes.
People are checking in. They're tuning in. They're saying, how's it? You guys are welcome to comment. I don't know how much we're going to be able to see that, but hello. Anyway, hello, Julie Edwards. Let someone give her an applause here. You can't hear that.
I can't hear any applause.
Okay, good.
It's like per normal.
Sounds like our last few gigs.
Sounds like the last Needle show.
Okay, there we go. Now you can see your beautiful face. Hold on. No, that's not working. That's not working either. Okay. All right, brother, shoot, go.
Okay. So let me tell you about the study first.
Yes,
because I think
yes.
That's more important to give a backdrop of what it is. So when I did my master's, I did it in cultural relevance in songwriting.
Yeah.
Why people write the way they write. And my focus was on family murder. And I used Blue Eyes as a reference because the song is about family murder and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And then I got more interested in how creativity actually works between band members. And then I wanted to find out how does creativity evolve between band members and producers is the one thing. The other thing is, Does having a producer on an album actually constitute a better outcome? Is there more or less objectivity that the notion that we have as music lovers is more as that romantic notion of Bob Dylan wrote his whole album by himself?
Mm.
You know, or the whole Beck album was done just by Beck.
Mm.
It's like a romanticized version of what is actually happening behind the scenes. There's people mixing it.
Yeah.
There's this guy, you play a song to me and you say, hey, what do you think of the song? And I go, oh, cool. I think the chorus is too long, and you change the chorus maybe.
Yeah.
Even though you fully did the album by yourself.
Yeah.
There's all those other variables that happened.
Mm.
Sometimes I find that sometimes in creative relationships, it's quite the opposite of what I thought it was. Is like, you think that like a relationship, it does get better with time, but with time, the hierarchy evaporates. So what I mean by that is that, you know, when my band started making music, it was me and Arnu and the other band members did have an equal say, but there was an understanding who was strong at songwriting and who wasn't strong at songwriting. And as the years went by, we turned it into a full democracy, meaning that everybody's got equal say.
Yeah.
But now what happens is, say for instance, one guy is really strong with songwriting, and the three other oaks aren't that good with songwriting.
Yeah.
But they can vote him out.
Right.
It's not necessarily best for the song.
I know. I know. That is an interesting point.
You know.
The democracy part of it.
The democracy part of it is okay up until a point, and if there's a mutual respect from the other members knowing that the songwriter is the predominant guy and they trust and respect him,
yeah,
then a democracy can work.
Yeah.
But it cannot work without a hierarchy.
Mm.
I don't think so. Because there's so many examples of bands releasing first, second, third album, massively successful, two guys writing.
Yeah.
And then later, as everybody start writing together,
yeah.
It becomes a watered down thing. Unless you're like a Pearl Jam, that everybody writes in Pearl Jam. Like, and everybody writes in U2. Like that, it's like a,
yeah,
you know, where the Stones have kept their formula with Jagger and Richards.
Mm.
So there was this period for us. And what was really interesting about this period, this 1994, just after we became a democracy, and you go read academic journals about that time.
Yeah.
There's not much stuff written about Just Ginger or the Nude Girls. Or there's a lot of stuff written about Voel Vry and Afrikaans and Koos Kombuis. And it's a good thing, but it's almost like that. That little South African music explosion that we had never happened.
Mm.
Well, not.
What are you saying? It just wasn't documented well, or journaled too well.
Yeah, like there's not a lot of academic journals about, like a study about the Nude Girls.
Yeah.
Not that I could find.
No.
Not one about Just Ginger. We certainly mentioned at places.
Mm.
So the purpose of the study wasn't really it was a bit to add some academic knowledge about that little time that happened. But I do find that it was a special time creatively. And part of what happened was we had the World Cup rugby. We became a democracy. I believe all those cultural things, you know, gave a certain optimism to our country.
Yeah.
And out of this came a couple of bands,
yeah,
that did really well.
Yeah.
Whether it is because of the cultural aspect of what happened, like because we won a World Cup or because we were proud to be South African, because before that we weren't very much proud of.
No.
So, you know, there was a, what I could see is there's a massive creative part that happened in that time with a bunch of bands, with Ginger, with there was lots of bands, Lithium, Nine, there was Sugar Drive,
yeah, Arapaho,
there was many examples of that. And I think you guys were the first. You were the first mainstream contemporary rock band that outsold the US counterparts of the same thing. You outsold Pearl Jam. You outsold
U2, I think it sounds people like that, yeah.
And I don't think people understand the relevance of that and how big that actually is. If in your own country where you can sell, like, I think Pearl Jam's Vitality sold, I think it sold 40,000 units,
right,
when it came out,
yeah,
in South Africa. I think it was something like that. And Oasis was, it wasn't much more, but it was, you know, it wasn't a lot.
Yeah.
Your first album went double platinum.
Yeah.
You know. So the significance of those things is for me very interesting. And what's more interesting is that no one's really writing about it. This is like it never happened.
Yeah.
A lot of stuff is written about Kwaito and protest music. There's a guy, Druid, he writes about all the protest stuff, and there's a book called Policing Pop, and there's this Mankes writes about anthropology and Matanga, I think, and there's a lot of that, but not a lot about what we did.
Mm.
And what I want to do is, I'm just focusing on a couple of years. I'm focusing on from 1994 to like 2007, just that little era, and see how creativity evolved for each band.
Yeah.
So
what's this part of again? Just tell people again. Like, so you did a master's in 2018 for what? In what again?
I did a Master of Arts in Professional Practice.
Okay.
And so now I'm at UCT doing a PhD in Business Science, but with the focus on collaborative creativity.
Right.
So how do you get a bunch of people to work together successfully?
Yeah. Or how did you?
Yeah. Like, I mean, a part of it, I guess my first question to you was, when you did Was Something For Now, was that the first thing you did?
All Comes Round was the first album.
All Comes Round.
All Comes Round was the first album.
Did you meet everybody like at a jam night? I'm sorry to, I've never asked you this.
No, but like, that is funny.
Did someone call you and go like, hey, someone heard you sing in a bar?
Brent called me actually, because he was playing in a band called Tri-Funk Era with Vernie Skaltz and Tux on bass.
I remember Tux and Vernie.
Yeah, and so there was a place called the Randburg Waterfront, which used to really cook. It was quite a scene. Did you guys ever do that circuit?
Yeah.
It was very pubbish. It was very, very cover orientated. Like one of my first live shows I ever did was on an acoustic guitar with my friend Bruce Fulford, who's now living in Texas, or I'm not terribly sure. But like we had been busking on the streets of London, only because I'd got tired of picking lettuce, which is about as you do, you know, which is about the only thing a South African could do in the kind of 95s thereabouts. You could go over. I don't think you needed a visa, but obviously you needed a working visa. You could go and visit Lekker.
Yeah, you can go visit.
Everyone was going,
or you can say you visit.
Yeah, well, like everything, it's all about who you know. Yeah. And I remember going over, being okay, guys, I've arrived, new talent in town. I'm going to be the bar manager of this joint. This place sucks here in Piccadilly Circus.
Okay.
Like thriving cooking, and they go, yeah, you look very odd. You look homeless, and you got dreadlocks. Why not? Why wouldn't we choose it? Could you just show us your working visa there quickly? I'd be like,
yeah.
Listen, but listen, yeah, getting personal now.
Yeah.
Ask you,
oh, sorry,
this is working visa thing. I thought we were chums. And it was only then, when you'd realized that you'd made the move to get all the way out to London without a working visa, that you go, well, what can we do? And almost similar to the exploitation of most countries historically, of how they've exploited the, should we say, less fortunate or the less prepared. So I found an ad in the newspapers, and when we used to read newspapers, and they were Chichester, you can come cut lettuce for, like, bro, if it was £60 a week, it was a lot. And I was like, shit, well, I don't have a visa, so I gotta go, guys. I'm gonna go sharpen my blades. I've never cut lettuce in my life. So I was in Chichester cutting lettuce, and I was going, geez, this does suck. This is not cool.
This is not lekker, yeah.
It's not so lekker. But weirdly, I'd just written Shallow Waters. I didn't know what was going to happen with it.
Right.
So I'd written Shallow Waters already. It was the first, probably the third original that I'd ever written on an acoustic guitar.
When did you start? Did you start young?
Late, after matric. After matric, my music teacher, who I didn't study music with, he just was the music teacher at the school.
Yeah.
When I left, for some reason, he gave me an acoustic guitar, because I used to go up in the breaks and play piano. And maybe he saw a sign. Maybe he saw.
Yeah. Maybe someone sees me.
Maybe he sees. Maybe he'll notice. But
yeah.
But he gave me an acoustic guitar that only had two strings on it. And I was like, I don't know if this is more of a diss or if it's like six look like too
maybe
much.
Maybe this is what he thinks you can play. Let me give him two strings.
Exactly. So anyway, when I afforded to get the other four strings, I I had a book. Remember in the books in the days when they used to have the dots on the pictures?
Yeah.
To show you the chords. Like a dot there, and finger one, finger two, and finger three, there's a D chord there. And I remember this was pre-drugs, bro. I didn't know anything about drugs. and I remember sitting up all night, which later on only became because of drugs.
Yeah.
I sat up all night going, yeah, see, what is this funny book with the buttons and the things like that? And I end up learning like six chords that night, you know, overnight.
Okay. Just
like, dung, dung, dung. It sounded like crap. And from the moment I could do that, as soon as I could piece like two or three chords together, I was already singing like original melodies over it. And I thought it was like, wow, like, yeah, see, this is kiff.
Yeah.
So the third song that I'd ever done was Shallow Waters. I'd written the song, and then it was the shortest career of all time. I'd learned four chords,
yeah.
Wrote a song called Shallow Waters, and then because of the chick and I had to leave,
yeah.
I was like, that's it, I'm giving up music. Haven't even started.
Shit.
Hadn't even started music yet. So I was cutting letters in Chichester, and a friend of mine had he had a Walkman stall, you know? So this is giving our age away.
Yes.
And I remember I was like, yeah, see, bro, I'm getting hard full of this. Give me your hi-fi there, or your headphones.
Yeah.
Put the headphones on. It was Pearl Jam, and it was Sting, Fields of Gold.
Okay.
And these things. And I was like, this sounds incredible. This is music. that's what I need to do with my life. It's beautiful.
Yeah.
And then we went on strike and like threw the blades down, and I was like, Bruce, buy a djembe drum. I'm going to come and jam. I know four songs. We're going to start busking.
Yeah.
And he's like, so that's going even way back before Ginger.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then, how did Brent get hold of you?
Okay. Yeah. So, so Brent was now, he was hoeing. He had like a 28 pack. He had this ponytail. The chicks were going vilt for him. And the band cooked. Trifunk Era cooked. They were really, really good. Sax was incredible. He still is. And Vernie, sensational musician, and they were playing at Firkin or something like that, or Morgan's Cat.
I remember that place.
Yeah. And I was playing at another little place called Mexicola or the Mexican or something like that. And then I eventually upgraded to the Firkin as well on like a Wednesday. And they played at least three nights a week. And Bruce and I would go and watch Trifunk Era and just go and stand there and go, what is this full band going nuts, just playing. Who's this? Oh, Brent, you know, like watching, like, sure. And then I'd go back with my dreadlocks, and I looked like a Berge. I still do, but I look
like a bit older Berge.
Yeah. Now I just look like a more bald Berge.
No.
And I went back, and I remember one of the shows I was playing. Shallow Waters was now part of the repertoire.
Okay.
I was like, hey guys, you mind if we do an original? And I was like, yeah. The drunk, there were like four people there that didn't care. So I'd play, and I think Brent came in, he saw me do Shallow Waters once. And then I'd go and watch him, and then they'd come watch us. And then we'd just got the first Nokia 2333 10s in those days. The things like this, they have exactly 20 minutes battery life.
Yeah.
1 minute.
And a snake game.
1 minute call time and a snake game.
Yeah.
And I was staying in, I can't remember the area. My God. Anyway, I was staying in Joburg somewhere.
Yeah.
And I was sharing a house with Bruce, and we were playing, and I was busy practicing bass pedals on my feet and going, yes, we're going to make a whole show of this. And the phone rang. I was like, oh, that's odd. Shit, this thing actually works.
Yeah.
This is technology. And I picked it up, and Brent is like, odd. I was like, Brent, how's it, bud? Like, we haven't really met. He's like, you're going to be the singer of the band. We're going to start doing original music. Can you give it a good... And I was like, well, it's a little bit awkward. I'm kind of with a band. Yeah. We're in a band, but you guys are really cool. And Bruce at the time had met a girl in London who wanted to marry him. And so I was like, bro, I think I've been offered to be in Trifunk Era. And he was like, bro, go for it. I'm on my way to LA anyway to go and marry my wife to be my future ex. And so I was like, to Brent, I was like, yeah, of course, I'm your man. Let's go. When do we start? So that was Trifunk Era, and now there were four of us.
Okay.
Ah.
Yes. Sis.
What do we do then?
When you started playing, did Galakis?
Yeah.
Did he approach you?
No, Galakis is a little bit after the case. Because I remember we did a showcase for BMG Records at the Firkenstall, but then we were cooking. Like the club was full. It was for some reason it was full already. But it was mainly because of Trifunk era. But now this homeless dreadlock person that was in the front, he could kind of hold the tune pretty okay.
He sang
the covers almost like they sounded, and then they had these things called original songs as well.
Yeah.
And then I don't know, but someone was like, "Oh, the people from BMG are in the front chair." Then I'm like, "Oh, I don't fucking care. I don't know. I don't know.
What is BMG?"
I didn't know what BMG. I had no idea what a record company was. No idea.
Yeah.
And we did the show and we cooked and I mean, this, they obviously called us in for a meeting, and then we had kind of like temporary management, if you want to call it that. We just had two people who were really just interested in our kind of well-being, if you want to say.
Okay.
And they were kind of guiding us, and they said, no, we've got a lawyer to come look at the contract and you should sign the deal. We were like, hell yes, a record deal. Of course. Are you joking?
Yeah.
I'd only just heard of this thing called a record deal.
Yeah. I mean, people will pay me money to do things.
Yeah. I mean, little did I know that I was signing my publishing and the record deal in one contract.
Nicely.
Yeah, lovely. Yeah, which is not recognized outside of South Africa. It's the only place in the world where it's legal. It's two separate contracts altogether.
Yeah.
And that's a whole...
But it's like if you've got no money.
Mm. Well, it's not like we made any money. We just signed a contract where we gave them all our money forever.
Yeah.
Which is... That's the truth.
Like... So where did you do All Comes Around then? What studio did you...
So they ended up... We ended up going to Bop Studios.
Really?
Yeah. And it was actually at the same time as they were doing the
Lion King.
Lion King, yeah.
Oh, right. Yeah,
it was either before or after.
So who engineered it?
So we had a producer called Reggie Bowman from Australia.
He was out. Right. Yeah, he did the Sugar Drive as well.
Uh-huh.
Reggie Bowman did Sandman Sky.
Okay, cool.
So he did
All Comes Round, yeah.
Oh,
so he produced, but I also remember there was a lot of pre-production involved. We were at the BMG building back in the day, and we were going to play the songs, and then he was around for quite a while. He was like, no, we've got to do this, cut that chorus, put this verse in, yeah, and this, the stuff that producers do.
Yeah.
You know, back in the day when going on to your point of like, what was the relevance in the relationship between a producer and the band? I think it's still very important, but I do think when you talk about the evolution and how the creativity evolves as to whether it's absolutely necessary or not, I think that's really just up to the creator and the artist.
Yeah.
Because for sure, a producer has a place to, in the synergy, especially in the wild, in the Wild West before the bands knew that it was actually a business. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And they were like, we're just going to go and get drunk and play music, you know, and hopefully score some checks.
There has to be someone going.
There's got
to
be someone going, no, that you can't do 18 choruses because you're on tick. Because it's because it feels good. Not that I've ever done tick. Mom, and I think mom's watching. Love you, joking, obviously.
And then your relationship with Brent and Tux, like the interrelationships between you guys when you're creating something. When you did that first album, when you did like Stand in Your Way, and was it you that came, or was it a band dynamic? Was it like all of you came? You came with something like, I know Shallow Waters was your song, so you came with that song.
Yeah,
but was it equal say?
It was very much Brent driven in the day, and Vernie. I would say Brent and Vernie had a big part. Tux was kind of just like happy-go-lucky. He wasn't very present in the. I don't feel like he ever maybe even, and this was pre-me, I think he always felt like he was a hired gun, which in a sense he was. It never really, it was also the first band that I know of that even had anyone of color in the band, kind of like
that.
Yeah,
at
you know
the
what
time,
mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, so at the time. And I don't think, given the nature of how it was before that, I don't think he maybe even accepted it himself, you know, and truly understood that we were busy forming a band of brothers together.
Yeah.
I think he felt like an outsider, especially, I mean, I just dropped Brent off at the airport today. He's my brother. I love him to pieces. But he was a wild kid. He was like a bull in the china shop. I mean, the way he got, you know, he really, he was just, And wonderful, because that drove us into doing what we did. But he didn't always have the most tact, I would say. But in many ways, he also saved us a lot of like diluting a point. He was like, okay, you're doing that. And then somewhere on the outer edge, it doesn't look like a band.
Yeah.
So you can understand why Tux would feel like he wasn't really part of it, because it's go. So Brent, as soon as he heard Father and Father, I'd written a verse and a chorus.
Right.
And he was like, he's like, that's the song that's going on the album. And he'd go, come, okay, show me the rest. He goes, okay, let's put this lyric in here. And I was like, oh, okay, you want to put, okay, cool.
write a lyric. Okay.
But Brent's also had written some beautiful demos that I sang on before I was officially in the band.
Okay.
Beautiful songs. Okay. Like, really good. He did Paradise in Summertime.
Okay.
That's a Brent song that Vernie helped him transpose, because Brent doesn't have any melodic instrument background. So Vernie did it. So it's also partially co-written by Vernie, I would say.
Okay.
And he did a bunch of songs. State of Boy was another Brent and Vernie collab. Where was it going with that? So he would, he was always very melodic. So he's a very songwriting kind of guy and very driven. Yeah. So if I had just a half an idea, he would come on and we'd finish it, and then it ended up being a bit of a collab already in those days.
Okay.
That said, there were complete songs like Shallow Waters and No Idea, and a whole bunch of other songs from the record.
Who wrote Stand in Your Way?
Brent.
Really?
Brent and Vernie. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. I remember exactly, there's this thing like where were you in 9/11?
Yeah.
I knew exactly where I was when I heard that song for the first time.
No way.
I was on my way to a pharmacy, and the song came on, the beginning, the boom, boom.
Yeah,
boom.
So that, exactly.
And when the chorus first kicked in, I nearly started fucking crying. I was like, what the fuck? And at that time, later on for Nude Girls, it was kind of not cool for us to listen to Just Ginger, because we're like, fucking, it's a fucking alternative. It's incredible.
It was your guilty pleasure.
Yeah. It's like me listening to Limp Bizkit. And I think when you're young as well, you feel like it's someone you've never met, but this, it's not a rivalry, but you try to do better,
It was a natural thing.
So, but that song always caught me, and when I listened to it, it was always like, Jesus.
Yeah, it's a chorus.
I can write a fucking song.
That's
like
Brent,
that,
Mr. Brent Harris. I present to you. So that first record is very much a Brent and Mad coloring in very well, and he's also incredibly musical and.
Yeah.
What? Your show's been stopped because it contains audio or visual content that belongs to someone else. That is just the wildest thing. How? What did we do? Did we play something?
No, we didn't play anything. We just talked about it.
Facebook, I tell you. Oh, I love you.
Yeah.
Well, okay, well then it goes on to YouTube. By the way, there is YouTube for those of you who are watching. Please click and subscribe and all the bell things that all the people say.
Is it on back again?
I think it is. Let us know in the comments if this is still going. We still sing you. Okay, great.
Okay.
It's very weird, bro. I got blocked with so many things with songs that are mine. I played my song with the goat. Near. Someone. But that's very typical of how it's been with the record companies for me. They just own everything, and then you're not allowed to use any of it.
Of your stuff ever.
Yeah, but it's actually yours. Oh, but that's a whole nother tangent.
Bob Seger that never is it Bob Seger that Creedence Clearwater.
Yeah.
Is it Bob Seger? Who's Creedence Clearwater's lead singer?
I don't know.
I think it's Bob.
Come on, but guys, tell us in the comments.
Anyway, but he didn't own any Creedence shit until much later, recently. And Reggie's involvement, would you say he was steering or was he helping to write stuff?
No, he wasn't involved in a writing sense, but definitely a... an arrangement sense. He was really involved in that. Yeah.
Because I remember seeing, I remember going to the studio to watch
John Fogerty.
John Fogerty. Sorry, guys.
Jammer, sorry.
Fuck it.
I mean,
Fogerty.
A little bit before our time. Sorry, Anthony. Well done.
No, thanks. Here's the price.
I don't remember the lead singer for the New Girls was. Never mind.
Yeah,
I know. Never mind.
I can't even remember my own name sometimes.
Exactly.
I started recently, like, stopping thought in the middle of a thought, just going, what the fuck did I think now? You know, ask my wife to get something, like, hey, baby, and she comes. She's like, what? And I'm like,
hey, you look like her.
You look, I'm sorry.
So nice to see you again.
I'm sorry. I
missed you.
And then she's down the hall. I'm like, ah.
She said, I'm not falling for that again, you night.
No. So, and I went to the studio to, I see Paul Flynn invited me to, I sat in on a session for Sandman Sky because I was interested in production and.
Right.
And I remember how sweaty Reggie Bowman was.
Oh, really?
When he was like, behind that Harrison desk at Downtown Studios. I don't know if he was like that with you, but he was like, let's go.
Oh, wow.
Like, and I was like, jeez, this guy, I will die if I have to work with an oak that's so energetic. Because I'm more like, okay. And he's like, yeah. So I don't know if it was him.
No, I don't remember that same kind of manic energy. But I think we were all sort of so manic at the time as well that maybe it wouldn't have stuck out.
Yeah, maybe as well.
Because we were also like, oh, what the hell? This is crazy. We're at Bob Studios. I mean, are you kidding? Let's go.
Yes, that place is amazing.
Yeah, is it still functioning? Do we know?
Someone bought it private. It's owned privately now. I don't know. I know they sold the Focusrite console that I think there's only 10 of in the world, that they sold it to a private studio. So the Focusrite desk in Studio One has left.
Right.
And I think the Neve one, which is where Nude Girls, that we did the Kevin Shirley one.
Ah.
We did it on the Neve desk.
Uh-huh.
And I think the Neve desk and the SSL are still there in Studio 3.
Here he has Dion Cabana. John Fogerty, dude. Dion. I mean, I don't know. I don't know what meds we've been on lately. But
yeah, yes. I'm sorry.
Obviously, the drugs don't work. The verb
I'm never gonna live this down in my life.
Don't worry, there's two of us in here, bro.
Yeah, it's amazing that both of us didn't know. We're like,
I just said, you said clear and clear water. I was like, sounds like what
sounds
I drink.
Amazing, yeah.
I drink that when I can.
Yeah. It sounds amazing. What kind of drink is that? So
you guys, what album was that you did at Bob?
We did Surpass the Powers at Bob. We were actually supposed to, Kevin, we wanted to get a producer. Mm. We wanted to get Kevin. We couldn't get Kevin.
Right, everyone wanted to get Kevin. We would have died.
Couldn't get a hold of him.
Mm.
And we wrote him a letter, like a proper, one of us had email maybe.
Yeah.
And it never reached him. And he just did Silverchair, Frog Stomp just came out. And we were looking at other producers because Kevin was just too expensive.
Yeah.
Because he did Nine Lives and he did the Frog Stomp. He was staying in New York. And then we got a phone call from... at Sony saying he wanted to do the album, and then they went into negotiations and Kevin said, I'll do it for free.
Whoa.
I'll do the album for fuck all.
What?
Just pay me to get there. And he did the album for nothing.
I did not know that.
Yeah. He flew, we flew him down and we paid for him to be there, but he didn't ask us money.
Wow.
And then we flew to New York. We paid for the mixing room, but it's...
Oh, there goes the power. Ooh. If we look at Lucky, look. Whoa. Yes, we should have done it from the word go.
Yeah.
Look at our studio effects here. Look, like a donker kamerke.
Yes.
Actually, hold on. If I sink, there we go. Oh God. You got to tap the screen, Theo. You had bloody one job.
I had one.
Whoa, then now you got the torch on. Oh, now you're taking photos of me.
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Oh,
Lord.
Lol.
Oh,
lol.
Lol.
Lol. WTF, lol.
Okay, there we go. Keep touching.
I can keep touching
it. Every now and then, just keep touching your face. Okay.
Okay.
Let's see if it'll, there you are. There you're back. Okay.
So I said that to my wife as well. I said, okay, just okay. Keep touching it.
Yeah, just keep. There we go. Okay. Ah, look up. Look there. If ever you need reference, that's up. Yeah, lekker. Who else is on the 8 o'clock load shedding? Bro, yeah. How's this lighting? This is unbelievable.
We should only do. You should only do the podcast in, in load shedding.
That's exactly what I'm going to do.
So Kevin came down, and he did the album, but he was supposed to redo hits of our second album.
Right.
So he was supposed to redo Blue Eyes and Genie and Supergirl and all these albums. And when he arrived, the night that he arrived, it's the first time we met him.
Yeah.
He's like, okay, cool. So we're going to re-record these songs. And we said, well, we actually wrote a whole new album.
Right.
And then he was like, what? Because he obviously didn't prepare. He's never heard this shit before in his life. And he said, you know what? Let's record the new album and we re-record those songs.
Okay.
And so we did all of it. And yeah, it's amazing. I actually kept in contact with him. I still do. I talked to him last week.
I remember we were going to go to Australia. There was a time that we were going to try and jump onto one of his courses. Yeah. Back in the day when we were buying cars and Mustangs. Yes. And
Now
it looks like you're moving in with me next week.
Yeah, now and I drive a Honda. There's no more Merc. It's not just Honda.
Yes, we've all been clapped. So I came back from months at sea and I had a bunch of backpedaling to do because I hadn't worked the whole year. We're all in the same boat. Excuse the pun.
So when you did, after that, you did Something For Now.
Yeah.
Which is an EP, I think.
Yeah.
That's got Sugar Man on it.
Yes.
When you did that, was everybody still in the band, like the same lineup?
No. So Tux was going through a bit of a time.
Yes.
At the stage. And we had, and this is where we introduce a character called Denham Harding.
Ah.
Who, by the way, the backstory with that is that when I left school, matric, I didn't get an exemption, so I couldn't go on to become a lawyer like I always wanted to.
Ah.
Because I was a drummer in a death metal band and I discovered Zol. I wouldn't say that's the reason, because I've really not been a big smoker, you know that.
Yeah.
A lot of people always think because I had dreadlocks that I was a dealer, never mind the fact that I'm actually allergic to THC, quite sadly.
Oh, really?
Yeah. But in high school, you aren't. But it's also you smoking such jut, you wouldn't even know, which is what I'm saying.
Now, if you take a, you're afraid for the inside of your own brain, you know.
Exactly.
Back when in the 90s, you can smoke a half an arm of Zol.
And you can't get stoned. You're like,
yeah, and you're like, no, this cut's not working.
It's like, hey, bro, it's a hit you. No, nothing.
Now, people are, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, it's very strong. So my point is that I left school and decided to go and study drums at a drum college called I forget what it's called. This is terrible. Sorry, Andre Luke.
Oh, some in drum, Joburg.
Yeah, in near Cresta. I know Groove Class came from Denham and Vainis. Then they did it the year after me, but Andre had been giving lessons to this kid called Denham that he kept on raving about. Now, Denham had been in a band in a KTV TV show called The Kids.
Really?
Do you remember The Kids? Does that ring a bell at all?
Yeah.
The Kids. So Denham was this little, he was a sensation. He used to do...
He was like the Ricardo. remember Ricardo. Elvis,
he used to do Elvis covers and all sorts of things. And yeah. I mean, it was quite clear then already that he was very much talent. And and Andre always used to talk. He said, yes, you must see this kid called Denham. He plays drums like you can't believe. And I was like, but he's too young. Surely I'm going to be better than him. And let's do the course now. That was an MI course, PRT, the full-on PRT syllabus.
Okay.
And I was studying and I heard Andre raving. And I was like, okay, cool. Well, I hope I'll meet this kid called Denham. And I think he, like everyone else, was following Brent around town. All the discerning drummers and musicians had heard of Brent, who was playing in Walk This Way.
Yeah.
And just
that's thunder. When I met Brent. When he was in Walk This Way.
What a band.
Yeah.
What a band. That's, I mean, they were ridiculous.
Yeah.
I mean, Miller on guitar. Geez, I can't remember any of them. It's so bad. But an amazing lineup. Vic, lead singer, unbelievable.
Yeah.
So, excuse me. People would follow the circuit.
Yeah.
And go and watch Brent. Brent was a phenom. And this I think just because of that and by proxy, somehow Denim was now in the wings. So going back to your question, was it the original lineup? Brent, Denim's obviously a very likable guy, crazy talented, and he hung around the band. I can't remember exactly when if he was here, he'd tell us to the hour when we met and which direction we were facing.
Denim,
yeah. But I have to obviously just tell it from my perspective, which is blurry to say the very least.
No, it's okay. I just remember every time I speak to Denim, I end up for some reason. I promise you, I'm not really that type of guy, but I talk cuck when I meet when I see Denim, and I sometimes say stuff that's not even true. Where Denim goes like, no, it's that. Couldn't have happened.
Hi, my name's Grant.
I don't know why. I don't know why I did it. I love him, but I don't know why I do it.
Yeah, that is is an interesting confession to tell us now, because we've often said Jesse talks cock.
Somehow, when Denim's around, he just talks nonsense.
There's a chum of ours on the thing, Dave Hahn, one of the greatest photographers in this country. How's the legend? Bess, I met you at Oppie and you and Orna bought me a beer. I was 17 backstage. We have to put that back up again so we can read it. And never been sober since. Oh, good to have you back in SA. Missed your last gig. Anyway, Dave, love you very much. So you guys basically turned a fantastic photographer into an alcoholic. How do you feel about that?
That's awesome.
No, well done.
Glad to be contributing.
I mean,
to his
apart well-being. From talking absolute crap every time you see Denim, now you're also creating alcoholism. Thanks so much.
Alcoholism and talking nonsense.
No, wonderful. I mean, we all got our strengths. You
know? Like I remember we caught a flight, and I ended up sitting next to Denim.
And we're just talking cuck.
We're just talking cuck. That's when I still talk cuck. More cuck.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's when I met him the first time. He had this music knowledge of like, I was like, what are you talking about?
Yeah.
But you don't want to say it because you don't want to sound like an idiot.
So you just go,
I go, yeah.
I met him.
Oh, yeah. Like, triplets.
Like, what? Really? You met Paul McCartney?
Yeah.
We
flat seventh.
Yeah. 45.
45. Just confirming stuff that I don't know shit about. Like, if you're the flat seven.
Yeah.
Because I asked him questions about the Ginger songs. Like, so in this song, do you go? And he's like, yeah, we play a flat whatever.
And the only flat you'd ever had was on the N7.
Yeah. And I'm going like, yeah,
Denim does that. He is so knowledgeable. He's so damn knowledgeable.
And I get it. He's got a great sense of humor as well.
Well, he has to be to have stuck up with friends like us for all these years.
Definitely. So did he then get involved?
Yeah.
Creatively?
So back to...
It's quite interesting. Sorry to interrupt you. It's quite interesting that every guy in Just Ginger can play any instrument.
Well, except Brent. You can only play drums.
In my band... Everybody can just play what the fuck they play.
Right.
No one can. I cannot play the drum. And Arnu thinks he can play the. He plays the. That's his beat.
Well, Vernie, Vernie was a big, proper multi instrumentalist, properly. I just get by. None of us are as masterful as Denim when it comes to technicality, but that's a whole discussion that we are having, and you know, it goes into production that we were talking about earlier. But so at that time, to get back to your question, a long route around, we were recording something for now, and the Sugar Man session came up, and Tux, for a bunch of reasons, was a bit AWOL at the time. We don't need to get into it, but it was
AWOL.
We've all gone a little bit AWOL, and he wasn't there for the session. And Denim was like, hey, I'm around. I know things about stuff.
Yeah, I was in kids.
I can do the things. I was in the kids.
I was in the kids.
So what Denim totally did, being so talented and probably like really good, if you look back at it, like he spotted a gap in the market. he was like, Tux is not being very reliable right now.
And I am the reliable.
And he plays bass. I've never played bass in my life before. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to buy a bass guitar and I'm going to join a band. This is a fact. This is a fact. He actually he joined I wish I remember the name of the band.
I think he did the same with production with me.
Yeah.
It's like Oaks went like, listen, Crous is going off the rails here.
He can't produce shit anymore.
And then Denim went, listen.
Then listen.
I've got a plan.
Listen to me.
I'm going to produce the band.
So it's wonderful that I mean, you know, to be that talented enough for him. He had never played bass before, and he started playing.
That's amazing. Yeah.
With a friend of mine called Emin Rennie and whatever band he was in. So sorry, I forget the name of your band, Emin. But they were playing on the circuit, also at the waterfront. And I remember Denim coming back with his fingers were bleeding because he was just learning. He had literally he'll tell you where he got the bass from. But he was like, I'm going to learn how to play bass, not because that cover band needs a bass guitarist, but because I'm seeing a gap in the market here with just Ginger. He's doing very well.
Yeah. Some oak is missing.
I think it's the intro music. There is no intro music, Kerry. Sorry. Mm-hmm. Kerry, our moderator. Anyway, shout out to Kerry. Hope you're well. But so Denim ended up recording on that. And yeah, and the rest is kind of history because Tux went relatively permanently AWOL.
Okay.
Before a big show, and Denim was able to fill in.
Did the dynamic, or how would you say with when Denim entered the band? Because one thing that I've noticed is that you were involved from the start, but it kind of seems to me like it was not Brent's band, but he was running the vibe.
A proper driving force. Like when I joined, there was a very definite, like Brent and Vernie, they were like, you're lucky to be in this band kind of vibe. For sure. And in many ways, I was like, jeez, how lucky am I to join Tri-Funk Era?
Yeah.
And I just come and do my... You know, I do my thing to a very well-established band, and I definitely had that feeling. It was also the days of like people didn't know where the egos are and what they're doing. They didn't know we were forming a brotherhood, and things probably came out the wrong way that wasn't meant like that for whatever the reason was. But I certainly felt like an outsider.
Okay.
Until it hit, and then I was like, ha! You see, it actually worked. Look at this. You needed me. Well, yeah. I needed you in order to make all of this happen, and I wasn't. Wasn't the worst thing that's ever happened, and now can we all start being like equal, you know?
But what is amazing is that you've got probably the most beautiful voice in South Africa. You do. And it's amazing to me that, like, Arno started singing when he was... He's got photos for when he was 5 years old with a guitar. He could always sing. It's amazing to me that you just left school and you were like, oh, this is amazing. What I can do with this voice. I've never tried. It's like, oh, wow. You know, it's like me finding out now when I'm 50, like I'm a fucking good archer. Like, and I've never did archery before in my life, but I fucking like, I can shoot things from a mile
call
away.
Call squirt.
So yeah.
Yeah, it was all very lucky as well. I had one like a talent show competition when I was on the bluff because I could mimic very well.
Okay.
That was the only way I knew I could sing at all. But obviously, I had no idea that I had a voice outside of who I was mimicking. I did Nat King Cole, and I used to listen to the cassettes and go like, when I fall in love. And I'd get like, love, and the mouth sounds. I was like, but that's not me. Yeah. I was like, I can get it close, you know. So then I forgot about it. And then I was a skinhead death metal drummer. I was the drummer.
And what is your band called again?
Abhorrence.
I think I might have seen Abhorrence at The Doors.
Yeah, you may have.
In Jutta Street.
The Doors at Jutta Street.
Yeah, Brew Bonnie Simon.
Yeah.
I think I saw you. But back to... So would you say you became more involved? Was it more an equal thing for songwriting with Something For Now? When Denim...
came in, did Denim cause the dynamic between you and Vernie and Brent to be different in any way?
No, Denim was, if I was made to feel like an outsider, Denim, yeah. You didn't touch your screen again, Theo. No, I said, we're weg. We're not weer foto's
vatten. I've never foto's vatten in my life.
I don't know, how do we get this thing? Oh, you know what?
Yeah.
It's quite simple. Just don't have the auto off button. Okay,
I will never.
No, but that's my fault. I should know that.
You must never.
Screen off, never.
Sorry. You must never.
You must. Display turn off after never.
After ever, never. In your life, there I'm go. Ever okay. gonna okay. do it.
That'll never happen again. Apologies, everyone. We're back from outer space.
Yeah.
Look at that. Kijk hoe gigs are for me. Wonderlijke mens. Sorry about that. So if anyone was made to feel like an outsider, it was Denim. He came in under, like, we've now got the success of the first record. Yeah. Everyone's wind gehad, and he's just replaced the weakest link, if you want to call it that. And yeah. Shame. I mean, there was, you know, it was very much even kind of suggested that he must even just be like a sideline musician, even for live shows.
Yeah.
And it was just odd because Brent, Denim and myself used to hang out a lot, and there was a lot of other dynamics coming from management and things like suggesting these things. Yeah. And I don't really know. I'm still just there. I'm the singer. You can't hide me too much as you probably should have. But so you didn't.
Did it feel like something when you play together? Like feel why, you know, if you can. Like I remember when me and Francois and Arnu played together for the first time. It's like something just happened.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't even know. I mean, it was a jam night. So we were like, hey, these guys can totally join our band.
Yeah.
and was it something that you felt? Or was it something that you felt you need to work on?
No. If anything, it became a lot more rock solid with Denim in it because he is just so solid. I had my aha making music moment with Bruce the first time we were jamming at his mother's house. First time I was like learning acoustic guitar, and we were practicing for our little duo cover band.
Yeah.
And he was like on the drum kit. We'd come back from busking in England.
Yeah.
And we had set up, and I was like, we were just going over like REM songs and a couple of songs here and there. And I was like, holy shit, we're doing a thing called making music. I remember that being an aha moment for me. I was like, oh shit. So if you do that and you sing it the way it sounds on the record and you put the beat at the same time, then you are creating music. Yeah. So that was like a definitive thing for me. Not like a chemistry thing, it was more my first realization that I was actually making this thing called music.
Yeah.
So as far as the band evolution of going, shit, we're actually quite tight. I mean, Tux, for all his, let's call it unprofessional whatever it was, he was an unbelievable bass guitarist. He really was. He had that swagger, and it was also very out there. He was very, very unique. He had different voicings, and so the rhythm between him and Brent, the rhythm was already very impeccable. So Denim had very big shoes to fill. So it's not like I felt like when Denim said, when it was like, oh, now we've locked, because we had always kind of locked as a band. I don't know how to, it's a good question, but I didn't feel like, I didn't one day go, okay, shit, now everyone must op us.
Because I remember speaking to a mutual friend of ours, Marlon.
Yeah.
There was that guy that helped you, assigned your scooter.
Yeah.
And still, I was in LA like in September.
Yeah, yeah.
And we chatted about you guys. And Scooter says he hasn't since seen a tighter rhythm section in his life.
Oh, wow. I mean,
that guy does Sheryl Crow and he does whatever. And that's what he said.
No way.
He's never seen a tighter
rhythm section in his life.
No, I mean, I must, it's pretty hard. You know, it's hard to beat that in this country. If tight rhythm sections are what define a band, you know, which is a whole,
another
conversation, which obviously we realize isn't exactly what makes or breaks a band. I mean, in the days of Muso validation, obviously that was everything, and it's still amazing. We played on Sunday now at Carver Beach Club, and I don't know what's gone on with all of us. For all the flaws, we've all gone through life stuff. Brent's had some medical things. We never see each other. We live in different cities, and to answer your question, now more than ever in the last, maybe a couple of years, I get on stage and I go, yes, this is something pretty damn special. So I'm actually feeling it more now than I ever did then. I think also just because I'm a lot more grateful that we're able to do it at all.
Yeah.
And I'm also able to really step back and give it a nice bird's eye view of all of it, to be able to recognize the power that we have.
Do you find that as the creative relationship evolves through the years, that I said to you earlier that you get to the democracy thing, and sometimes the outcome that you want is not preferable because
you took it down to a vote.
You took it down to definitely, a vote.
Definitely.
You know?
In my mind, there's a bunch of songs that I presented to the band that I as the writer, thought a certain way. And and it was in the days of now, everyone's got an equal kind of vote. And especially when it's three of us, which it's been for the last 12 years, it's very easy for two to be against one. Without this hierarchy that you speak of, which I agree. Yeah. And looking back now, maybe the songwriter should have had two votes. Do you know what I mean?
or if there's a respect from, within the hierarchy where the two guys that know they cannot vote respects the songwriter or whoever the idea, and the man's or the woman's ability to write the song more than their own, that they will let it happen that way.
I think that could have been. But to answer your question, I think in my memory, there's probably about two or three songs that I would have liked to have ended differently.
Yeah.
And looking back at it, I mean, they're not terrible, and the suggestions were cool, and they were okay, but they weren't how I would have done it had I had the entire vote. And I did, but I don't know if the outcome would have been tremendously different. You know, I'm only able to think about that now, looking back at it. You know.
And so, when you did What He Means, that's your song that you wrote from.
Yeah, top to bottom.
Yes, that's amazing, eh?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, but I'll tell you, so on the producer note, so we had our guitarist at the time was Sandy Sheila.
Okay.
Who we took on as a producer.
Yeah.
And, you know, he definitely helped shape what was just a very standard song into a journey that it became. So his role in the song was very important, I believe.
Okay.
Because I remember when we were doing the pre-production for that album, we were sitting, we were going, okay, well, just instead of just going straight into a chorus, what about this little suspended thing before we go to the E and then we do a big chorus? And I'm like, well, I'd never thought of that before, but that's why you're the producer, so it looks fucking good.
Just do that one thing.
And oftentimes you're doing, are we playing this now for the 20th time? I mean, talk about killing the vibe.
Yeah.
And then you get gems like that. And that is where production really can be valuable. And especially, I think, as the writer, as you well know, you can get too close to the songs as well, where you don't have any perspective. Where it's very nice to have people like Denim and Brent and any outside influence to help give you perspective on the album. That definitely happened with me with Impossible Machines, because I did produce and write and engineer and perform everything on that album.
Yeah.
I was sitting here in this very studio.
I remember, in
2018. And I had my friend Alistair Murdoch from Arapaho, happened to be my neighbor, who I respected tremendously. And we used to go for coffees in the morning. And I go, I did this last night. I was like, what do you think? Just come and have a listen. He go, a song called Should Have Stayed. I did a guide vocal to the song.
Yeah.
I wrote that song also very quickly. Did a guide vocal late at night, and I was like, I'll see you for coffee tomorrow morning. Did the guide vocal, went and had coffee, and came back from the coffee. I was like, just come listen to what I did last night. What do you think of this? I said, I'm gonna sing it properly today. I promise you, I will.
Yeah.
And he listened to the vocal. He was like, if you touch if you touch that vocal, we're no more coffee for you. we're going to end our, you know, so it's little things like that, that you know, from someone that you respect musically, like I do Alistair, and like I do Denim and Brent and any reputable producer or musician, then it helps you get perspective. What I do find has happened more often than not is when you have people in your kind of inner circle, it's so quickly how people become producers, eh? In 2 seconds, yes, eh? Dude. You give them a pinky and all of a sudden they've rearranged.
My wife is a producer.
Yeah, I guess everyone. Yeah, I mean, who gives us more of a right than they do, you know?
Yeah. And like, I remember when we opened for U2 on the 360 tour, we went afterwards, we ended up at a party. And we thought it's going to be this massive party for many people. We thought maybe we should go because it's you two. And even though there's going to be 1,000 people at this party, we should go because they've invited us.
Yeah.
And we arrived and it was just us and them.
Oh, shit.
And it was just the you two and the Nude Girls and Huma Sakela.
Yes.
And now we're sitting at this party anyway. And Bono, I had preconceived ideas of him. Just because people talked about his God complex and whatever, and he turned out to be so nice, and he knew Blue Eyes, and he knew our songs and whatever. Anyway, the point I'm trying to make is, he says, "Do you like you?" I can't do an Irish accent. He goes, "Do you like your band, Theo?" And I go, "Yeah, I like them." And he says loud, like the edge is sitting right there, and he goes, "I hate my fucking band, Theo." And I go, "Really?" And he goes, "Yeah, but," and then he said, "but when we together, we fight, but when we're together and we're on stage, it's something bigger than us that's happening." And
interesting.
He told me this whole thing about they've accepted that, I mean, they don't fight the whole time, but they have differences, and they've accepted that the thing called you two is bigger than themselves.
Well, exactly.
It's not to do with anyone individually. Mm-hmm. It's a thing. And they honor this thing that they created together.
Yeah.
And that for me was very special, coming from him, to realize that it's not about him or about the edge or about anybody in the band.
It's about what they are when they're together.
Yeah. And at first I thought he was just dissing everybody.
Yeah.
And then he turned it and told me this thing, and I was like, wow.
I know.
That's amazing.
That's quite profound. And it's very true.
You know?
I think Denim and Brent and myself in particular have been very fortunate, because we also have happened to, more often than not, tolerate each other's company as well, and have been through so much together that we are brothers, being, you know, we also only child and kind of, you know, brought up like that. And we've laughed our way, I mean, just so much. Like, we tell the same jokes to this day and still bend over, you know, dying. So we've never really had, I wouldn't say we've ever like hated each other and had to get onto stage and then try and pull something out of a hat, you know. But I do hear that, and I know a lot of bands who can't stand each other. But when those three or four or five or six instruments come together, it is greater than the sum, you know.
Yeah, like, I mean, with Nude Girls as well. We've got I'm enjoying myself. Me and Arno fought the first year of the Nude Girls. We fought a lot, not physically, but we shouted at each other.
Yeah,
and we literally had disagreements for the first year of the Nude Girls, and then never again.
Right.
And then that was just like, it's okay. And what I wanted to ask about what he means is, were you feeling equal band member at that time? Just in terms of like what you said earlier, like you felt a bit outsider, but by the time you did that song, was it more equal?
Yeah, no, but we had been equal for a long time.
Okay.
Then I didn't feel like I had the freedom to be more equal. I think after the first two albums, after All Comes Round and Something For Now, by the time we finished Something For Now, I was like, hey guys, I'm really pulling my weight here.
Yeah.
I'm also in the band now. Okay. Exactly. And then Denim as well. You know, after you'd done the work that he had done, you know, that eventually, you know, the outside of kind of feeling, I would like to think eventually dissipated. And we worked hard at it. I worked hard at it to make everyone feel very inclusive. You know, just to keep, because I also understand egos, and you know, egos are a hell of a thing to have to work with from yourself, and especially, you know, this thing called lead singer syndrome. And obviously if anything goes well, or if anything buggers up, it's because of the lead singer, you know. And in my case, I was often kind of, after Brent had lost his initial kind of spurt of driving the band, I was driving, then some things were really good. I got us a record deal in LA just by accident, just by being on holiday there. Yeah. And I was like, oh, Kev. And then when it doesn't work, it's like, oh, but it's your fault. It's like, oh, but hang on. We're a band. I'm not saying they said it was my fault, but you hear what I'm saying? Like, if there's any highs and lows, it's usually the singer's fault. And if anyone was rude, it would have been the singer, which I don't know. So I've always been constantly trying to evolve, you know, checking my ego out. And and that's why I'm trying to get everyone to feel as included as possible. But during What He Means, it certainly wasn't a moment for me to finally feel free. It was one of the many, many songs I'd written. Very free. Okay. Yeah.
So I remember, I don't know if that place, La Med, still exists.
Yeah, it's called The Bungalow now or something like that.
Yeah, so we played with you guys. You just came back from LA and you had a tape of What He Means. And we went to my car and you played me the tape of the song.
One time's cassette.
Yeah, and you said, here is the new. How's the song? You were like amped.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, it's awesome. And I went back to Arno and this song is so awesome. So I'm down and excited at the same time.
Yeah.
Oh, it's awesome. Fuck it.
Yeah, exactly. Whatever. But you have to feign excitement in front of your counterpart.
Yeah. Like,
oh, that's really cool.
Yeah, it's kind of all right. It's cool. I mean, he talks about a lot of stuff about bees.
It's not as cool as us.
Yeah, it's not as cool. Yeah, we have songs like Babies Falling Out the Rabbit's Bum when I come.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know what he meant.
I didn't know what he means.
Yeah, what he means, not at all.
And Peter Lacey's been listening in here. You know that name. He said the first time he heard Parkview Golf Club, we had played golf, and I also played in the same tape. It was probably stretched by then. He said, those are the days when you used to go, hey, come listen to the demo in the car, and you get click. No, next. Okay, wait, okay, go back.
That's the previous song.
Have you got a pen in the car or a pencil? Okay, I think this is the first song.
Yeah, and then you have to, if you listen to it in a buddy's car, you have to first adjust his bass and his treble.
Because you know that he's pushed the bass all the way through the floor.
Did you put the system on flat? It's the system flat.
Yeah, because we mixed this.
We mixed it. So you can't have the treble all the way up, bro.
Yeah.
This is not how it's supposed to sound. Rewind it.
And you just... Meanwhile, then you get it flat and it still sounds cut.
And then you say, but look, it's not mastered yet. Yeah.
That's always the throwback. Listen, it's not mastered, eh?
It's not mastered, but I'll play it to you.
Yeah, but the mix is cuck and the arrangement is terrible, but it's not mastered.
It's not mastered yet, eh? Fuck it. What would you say is... what would you say is the if you have a prerequisite for a successful creative relationship in a band? Do you think time plays a factor? The longer you know someone?
No, because I think there can also be fire. Hold on, I actually just want to quickly go live here. Let's see if this is either going to be amazing or the worst idea I've ever had. But either way, I'm going to do it.
You're going to do it anyway.
I'm going to do it anyway.
Just do it, bro.
Yeah, bro. I don't care. You know me, bro. I'm wild.
Just clap it, eh?
Let me see if they can. No. Okay, I'm going to do this. And if people see that screen. Let me just see. There we go. Oh, no. Oh.
There we go. Instagram live. Welcome, Instagram.
No, they can. They can also now watch.
Okay.
That's a beautiful thing about having a very good internet connection. Ah, oh, here's Darren Peens. He's from Digby and the Lullaby. He says, "Get married." He's like,
"Get your tongue out his ass."
Hey, this is a kid show.
Oh, sorry, man. Kids.
Darren and Richie Digby and the Lullaby. They are such an amazing couple, first of all, but also incredible musicians, and they're currently living their best lives. They've just decided they bought an old Jürgens caravan.
Yeah.
And Darren's an incredible cinematographer, and they've just decided to blog their travels. So if you guys get the chance, if you're wondering what was happening to Digby and the Lullaby, they're still making music, but they've just decided to document where they're. I think they've got 27 kids now. I'm not too sure. I stopped counting. After the when it got into the double digits,
okay.
And I see old Ian from the music kitchen saying, "How's it? Thank you. I'm going to be there on the 11th of June." Just quickly, by the by.
Oh,
just
right.
A quick punt. I hope
that's
it's
a
11th.
Nice venue.
I love the music kitchen. How passionate is that? Have you ever seen people? Ian and Renee just love South African music.
No, I love it every time we go there. It's really awesome.
So I'm looking very forward to getting back there. I'll probably be playing with old Nish. Pile on the tablas.
Oh, right.
And Denim should still be with us after we do the Brandy Fest in J Bay on the 10th.
Yes.
So Denim's going to come play. It's going to be Yalsadung. And don't forget the Brandy Fest on the 10th of June at Lombardini Game Farm with the full Just Ginger and a whole bunch of other bands. So that's going to be very kiff. It's going to be very poppy. It's not gonna be cool. It's gonna be kiff.
Yeah, it's just gonna be like cool and shit.
Yeah, you know, sorry, but
I remember when Arno was in another band called Gaia. I think the band was called Gaia.
Yeah.
And I'm like in on the deal. Like I've jammed with Arno. I want him to be like in the band with me, but we jammed and he's in Gaia, and I want him to fucking leave Gaia, and he's like, yeah, he's gonna leave Gaia. And I'm trying to talk to his bandmates, and I'm sorry, guys, if I offend any of you, but like they were so fucking cool. They want to talk to me.
Who, the Gaia band?
The Gaia band. Right. Yeah, I was like, hey, how's it? They're like, oh shoot, bro. And eventually he left Gaia, and then. So what I was asking you is about time. If time makes a difference.
I don't know if it necessarily leads to better stuff, because there's also something about the fire of the unfamiliarity of a new environment and new people.
Yes.
And also the kind of time and space, the environment has everything to do with it. So you're like, fuck, I don't really know these people, but I've got a song, and some of us are drunk, some of us are sober, so like we haven't really met, so there's a bit of weird energy. And then you get comfortable, and then sometimes it gets very stagnant, or sometimes because of the familiarity, you can actually really like start dissecting a song, and you can create good, like exceptionally good. I don't think there's any rules. I don't think the longer you stay a band, the more you evolve or have freedom creatively. Yeah. I think it really depends, because some bands also are together for one album, never to be repeated again.
Yeah.
Everything else they release is absolutely trash. Or it's the only album that they ever do, but sometimes you'll find the circumstances that they were under while they did it. It's nuts. The bass guitarist was in a relationship with the lead singer's husband.
But there's a lot of evidence to suggest that first and second albums, how great they are. And I was wondering if there's something about the unfamiliarity of knowing someone and the innocence of just exploring something with someone you don't know.
Yeah.
If there's merit to say,
I don't think there's rules, bro. I don't think there's
very few albums where they go like, their 10th studio album really did awesome.
That was the one, because they grew up together, and they said, it's like,
except Exile on Main Street.
Yeah.
I mean, but I think it was different because they fled to the French Riviera, the Stones.
Right.
And Keith Richards had a boat called Mandrax.
Rubbish.
I promise you.
Really?
Yeah, he was into
Mandrax.
Quaaludes.
Clearly. and that's what Quaaludes are.
Yeah, and his boat was called Mandrax.
You lie.
I'm serious.
I'm the worst pirate rock star in the world. I named my bloody boat after my album. Never mind a kiff drug.
Yeah.
I'm not a kiff drug. Drugs are bad. Yeah, drugs are bad.
It's called it Mandrax, bro.
Well, Mandrax boats.
Yeah. It's kiff, bro. What's your boat called? Oh, it's Mandrax.
Oh, man. Oh, Mandrax.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's, I mean, that's essentially it. I think that there's, what I do with data like this is I go listen back to the data.
Yeah.
And through various interviews with you, and I'm talking to Sean Morgan, and I'm talking to name dropping.
I'm lifting my freakies. Yeah.
And to various other singers and producers and stuff. And what I do with this information is I even though it looks like we're shooting the breeze for 2 hours, is I try and get commonality between certain things,
right?
And try to find certain elements that there's synergy with,
right?
You know, and even though we might think that nothing happened now, you can, if you listen back to it, you go like, oh, okay, cool, and you find like there's like another guy that goes, yeah, for sure, this happens,
right?
And
what are you hoping to achieve from the collection of this data and finding the commonalities and whatever parameters you find out of this collection of data? What do you hope? You just want to compile or to try and explain how that boom happened, which was a period in time, or is it a way to navigate doing stuff going forward?
Yeah, I mean, the one is it was a definitive time of excitement in our country. We were all optimistic for the first 4 years of the democracy. We were... every South African was. I mean, I remember how empty the streets was when we did the World Cup. Like everybody watched the World Cup.
Mm.
And but more than that, to see if there's actually a commonality that happens through a cultural event as well, such as the World Cup or democracy, whether that has anything to do with creativity. And also whether the outcome of those albums would have been different had the dynamic been different or had there been no producer at all.
Right.
You know? Yeah. I don't know if you, when you did What He Means, the guitarist was the producer.
Sandy, yeah.
So was he credited as the producer?
Yeah,
was he?
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Because sometimes like in Folk of Polisica, like Johnny would be the producer, I guess, if he had to put them. But I don't know if he's, I'm not sure if he's credited credit. For that. But he is.
Right.
He's the guy that's.
Well, that's, I mean, that's the thing, you know, a lot of band arrangements work very differently. You know, a lot of bands have different publishing arrangements as well. Some people, and you'll know full well that like you go, well, the lyrics count for 40% of the rest is X, Y, Z. And if you wrote three words out of the 17 that exist, then you own 30. I mean, there's so many different ways that you
and
can.
And those things, when you've got no money and you start making money, makes a massive difference. Yeah,
exactly.
I wrote that A minor.
Yeah.
I definitely wrote. I remember I said we go to the A minor.
Yeah, and I wrote the words and again and again and again at the end.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Really.
Okay, that's cool. Awesome. So we just get your name on the publishing sheet there quickly. Little did they know that we rarely see any of that money. I mean, geez, bro, the amount of money. I mean, I think we sold close to 500,000 records all in.
Yeah.
And I'll tell friends of mine. People look at the Finding Sugarman or Finding Never, the Searching for Sugarman movie, which is amazing. I mean, I'm a massive fan, as you know. But I'm going like, I feel like I'm a current story of that. Like, you know, like, and a lot of the musicians of that era are like, we got no money for that. Unless there's something that our then team have to still tell us. But I mean, 500,000 records, we couldn't have been that wild that we forgot that we got paychecks because we got nothing. Like, I do remember one check for 30 grand. And I remember Brent and I pulling it together.
I also remember a Blue Eyes check for like 20 grand. Yeah. And I was like, what?
Bro, that's 500,000 albums. Like, bro, I know I come from the bluff and my math is not that good. But if we got 1 rand for each album, that should at least be 500,000. That would be a lot of money then. That would have been crazy. But
no, I also remember we got no. I mean, the amount, we're five guys in the band. We're not like...
But then you were sharing 10% of royalties. So you can understand. Of which they first recoup... Oh, anyway, it's such a scam. It really is a scam, and I will say it. But to be honest, I've kind of really run out of energy to go now do a deep audit and like, am I going to go back that far? Unless someone's bored and they want to help us, they are welcome to. If you want to find out where all the missing money went, that would be fantastic. Yeah. Whoever's listening right now. But I mean, geez.
I think we got paid what we were supposed to be paid, but I just think we were such a large band with so many. There's management and this guy and this oak and band members. And, you know, like eventually we do one trip to England for a month. We take our whatever money we made on tour and we spend all that money and we come back with nothing.
Well, the record company forwards it to you and then you end up paying for it the rest of your life, I guess.
I remember this last story, funny story. We go to Germany to go promote our single and we book ourselves into this cuck fancy hotel. Like Metallica is also in the hotel. It's like that vibe, you know? Like, and they think that... And we have a party and you know, we go to Germany and we come back and like 8 months later, we've got another meeting, a round table with the record company going, listen, so how's our single doing? Why is there no marketing in Germany?
Yeah.
And they go, you remember that trip that you did? Remember that millions in the 90s? Remember that $1.5 million
Yeah.
That you spend in Germany in a week?
And you go, no. And you go, ah.
So that's where the marketing is.
Yeah.
Sorry, Oaks.
Yeah, I mean, I know. Listen, we were very ignorant. I keep on saying it's before the days when bands realized that we were a business, you know.
I mean, we had
no idea. You're joking.
If we were selling, no one was printing CDs in South Africa when we printed our CD.
Yeah.
So we met a guy from America called Lemmy. He was here. And he had a friend of a friend that could get CDs printed in Canada. And he printed us 500 CDs.
Yeah.
And we thought, fuck, how are we going to sell this 500 CDs? We just fucked ourselves. I think it cost us like $7,000.
Yeah.
And then we sold 500 and then we're like,
let's do it again.
So maybe we should do it, but I don't think we can do another 500.
Yeah. Let's make 250 because we spent all the money already. The backwards.
And eventually we sold like 1,500 of these CDs. So, and we probably made more money out of that 1,500 CDs than what we made after that signing with Sony.
Well, especially after being in that hotel with the Rolling Stones. I mean, yeah.
Yeah.
Metallica. Yeah, but we were young then. I guess it was part of what formed the creativity and the urgency and the pioneering things that I'd like to think we kind of did to the landscape. You know, like we also, like the only kind of story that I put out, you know, you guys first, because you were certainly a couple of years ahead of us, but on the back of that first record of ours, I mean, we played so much and everywhere. And we turned places that were just like regular bars all over South Africa into live music venues that a bunch of bands, you know, eventually carried on playing on and kind of created a circuit that didn't exist before, you know.
I also find that when the country started going, not backward, I wouldn't say backwards, well, probably politically, later, you know, towards like the early 2000s, it was evident that you know stuff was happening with our government. That it's amazing how directly you can correlate sales and pride in South African music, and correlate that to what goes on in a country, because before that was just American music everybody was listening to, and there was Afrikaans music and Kwes and Anton Huesen and those in like even Rabbit and Yes, and but like for a moment there we were outselling anything international. Not us, bands, Kwaito, hip-hop, everything. And as the situation worsens in a country or something happens to a country, the pride culturally also changes.
Yes, that's interesting. You know, very
like,
interesting.
Like sales drop.
Mm. Don't forget, we also did. I totally agree with you, and sorry to interrupt as well. But we also did then immerse ourselves into the beginning of the Napster era.
Of course, yeah.
MP3, digital streaming. No one, the value of a song, of the production of one song, and never mind an album, really started depleting. Just weirdly, I remember when that comparison was made. Years ago, 15 years ago, when memes were first coming out, they were like, you walk into Starbucks and pay $6 for a cup of coffee, but you won't buy a song that a band paid a couple of hundred grand to make for a dollar when albums were $10 still. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I mean, so that disparity has been around since then already, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I read something the other day that the majority of Spotify income and Apple Music income derives from a couple of artists.
Yeah,
the Drakes and the.
That's the 1% thing.
And Taylor Swift's and you know of the world and then the rest is us all fighting for like a couple of cents. You know.
Yeah, I know. So it's an interesting. The streaming world has certainly not worked for us. Nowhere near as when pound for pound selling albums was undeniable. Do you know what I mean? Because that's the album sales that's left the warehouse. Whereas now you're comparing streams versus popularity and what money are you getting?
Yeah.
So it's very hard to be a streaming artist these days. Well,
and it's
very
more
hard
about,
to make money.
It's more about, I actually heard someone say the other day that it's, you know, it's less about music and more about popularity, you know?
The social media era that we live in. If you just do clever TikTok videos, you're the biggest star in the world. It doesn't matter what music you accompany it with. I think Arctic Monkeys were definitely one of the first to really use social media to their advantage. I remember that, and I was going, look at this. There's this thing called YouTube and Twitter, and do creative music videos. So there was also just a whole progression of how it kind of all went. You know.
Yeah. So what do you think is the future of...
I think albums are dead, personally. I don't think forever, and I think there'll be a resurgence, and there'll always be purists who and true music appreciators who appreciate the effort that went into creating a story from track one down to... I was so annoyed with iTunes. It took me forever to realize that the only way to play an album in sequence is you got to press the big play button on the top. Otherwise, if you click the first track, it just shuffles. I'm like, dude, guys, come on. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm relatively tech savvy, but I mean, were you killing the way we've done the album? I remember Danny was like, screw this Apple Music stuff. How did you click on track one and the next song comes as number 7? He's like, oh, you got to hit the play button on the top or it won't play it in sequence. I was like already then, like I'll... Saving Grace, the streaming platform, is also not portraying the record that we have spent so much time and so much money on going, okay, so now the end of track two is going to fade and then the little thing from track three is going to come in and now just randomizes everything.
It ends off with a C and starts with an A minor.
Awesome. Exactly. So I don't know what the future is. I know personally, just also because of how busy life has become and owning a darn boat in another country and you know keeping my little bubble alive, which is essentially just mum and looking after the studio in this place. I don't know if I'm going to be able to get enough time to sit down and do an album as such. I'm desperate. I've got songs that need to come out, but I think they're going to be on a song for song basis. Also because, as you well know now, you just put an album out, it just gets so lost in the noise and the wash, you know.
Singles are the way to go.
Yeah,
I mean, if you, certain bands can release albums, and The National just released an album. I thought it was great of them to do that.
Yeah,
but for most of us, it doesn't make sense to go spend all that money on something that's going to get lost. You know, you need 4 singles to carry you through a year to keep yourself relevant as an artist.
Yeah.
You don't need a whole album.
Mm-mm.
And if you keep on doing that, just single every 3 months, see where it takes you.
Yeah.
Get on a playlist.
I agree.
I think that's probably the way to go, unless you're so established that people, you know, take notice when you do. If you're a big band,
if you do anything, yeah. Oh. Yeah. So that is very true. The one cool thing that we do have is that we are still performing artists. And as Brewer just said there in the comments as well, it's like, you know, watching live music fills the passion bucket every time. And that you can't replace yet.
Yeah.
ChatGPT-4 is pretty strong, but until they get an exact hologram replication of me, it's not really going to, it's not going to be able to replicate the live experience. So we do still have that.
Yeah.
But it is interesting times, but especially I had a friend of mine while I was sailing, Sean Nicholson, and ChatGPT-3 had just come out, or 3.5 had just come out. And he said, bro, you're not going to believe what I did. He said, I hope you don't mind. He said, but I took the lyrics to what he means. Yeah. And I said, rewrite the song and give it a nautical theme.
Yeah.
Bro, it was so beautiful. I've still got it. I was like, who the hell wrote that song? And it was months ago. So you must remember the advancement of technology is when I say something months ago, that was an eternity ago because it is evolving so quickly. So I think our newest challenge is going to be, and I mentioned it on a previous podcast, I think our new challenge is going to be the next time you play me a song, how are you going to prove to me that ChatGPT-4 didn't write it?
Yeah.
How are you going to?
I don't know.
So I had a little, it'll be awesome to hear any comments, if there are any at all tonight, but I appreciate those who have commented already. But like an idea that I had is like, I want to, now that I've got one or two extra little cameras, I want to have like an old school writing pad and a downward facing camera with a light.
Yeah.
And it's going to be a live writing view of writing a song from scratch.
Okay.
Because how else do you prove that you wrote the song in this day and age?
No, you can't.
It's brilliant. I've got a ChatGPT-4 up on my computer all the time. It's wild what we can get it to do. It's wild.
No, insane. It's insane what it does. I mean, it taught itself. You know, it taught itself. It was originally just English, ChatGPT.
Right.
And the other languages, that it taught itself those languages.
Yeah, right.
So it didn't make like a Russian ChatGPT. That it taught itself.
Yeah.
It can speak Afrikaans. It taught itself how to speak Afrikaans.
I mean, I am an Elon Musk fan, but I think he buggered up there when he created OpenAI. He later sold and has regretted it. I mean, obviously we're still in an era now where it's actually very exciting because I love it because I've got a personal assistant for $20 a month. Like what's $380 a month for a PA, which is also sad to think in itself, although for so many people who could do that job.
Yeah, and just stuff for websites, like stuff.
Unbelievable, writing codes, writing songs. They'll give you a marketing strategy for your next single and they'll write a storyboard for you.
Yeah.
It's like, it's wild what's out there.
Crazy.
Peter Lacey saying there are tools that can detect if it was written by AI. Recruiters use these tools to aside CVs written
I know, like for my PhD Turnitin that we use for checking, it can tell 100% if it was written. It gives you a probability. It says there's a 60% chance that this was written by AI. So for PhD writing, academic writing, there are checkers out there. He's right.
Yeah,
and it evolves as the AI evolves.
That's the thing. That's the thing. So there's also a difference between how do you fact check a songwriter where there's no comparison of that song before, whereas when it comes to your academic side, they're checking for plagiarism, which can also really be scrutinized and checked, in the algorithm or whatever. But I'm saying when it comes to a unique 10-sentence song.
First of all,
anything that's been written in the last 40 years would all trace back to the Beatles anyway. So we've been ripping it off since then anyway, just without AI checking it out. You know what I mean? If you really want to deep delve into that, all of music is borrowed, as we well know. There's nothing that we have ever done, I'm sorry to tell you, is original, but it's been that of every band for the last 50 years. It's not.
I'm going to go home and kill myself.
Theo, last scene. Driving, skidding out of Art's driveway.
Where did you find him?
But in saying that, let me give a little bit of upside to this. There are ways and means to use this technology to that can enhance us. And so what do? You just have to adapt. You don't stop writing. You don't stop creating. So you just find ways to prove your originality and how to stand out from the crowd.
I think any human element, like I heard Brian Eno talk about the human element, the fact that we're trying to make stuff so perfect and the whole human element of music is going away. And I think any piece of art that's got to do with human performance and originality, it's a bit off, and that kind of thing will never go away. Stuff like dance music, maybe that's just so mathematically perfect. Maybe even, dare I say, metal to a degree, where it's so heavily, some metal is heavily
quantized.
That would probably be easier for AI engine to remake because it's so perfect and edited.
Yeah.
Whereas the human element of it and the imperfections of what we known to love music for, that, I don't know when that will change.
Yeah. Well, it's evolving so quick, they'll probably learn to be human sooner than we can be. But good point. Nice try. We're doomed anyway.
Yeah.
Anyway, thanks, guys. That's the end of our broadcast. It's been lovely. Music's on the up. I'm joking.
Thanks.
Anyway, man, it is really just interesting times. I had a conversation with my first mate on board the Impossible Machine when I said goodbye to him now in Grenada.
Yeah.
I was like, Ethan, I'm intending to be back as soon as I can. I said, but I'm going back to a very unknown state of the world. I would love to be back. I don't know when ChatGPT, I keep on saying that all the time, when something is going to happen, that I can't even fly back here to carry on this little sailing adventure, which really goes back to my point and my narrative that I try and express to everyone, is really, really just try and enjoy the present, because we don't know how much longer we have it for.
No.
And more
and
so
this
than
stuff
ever
is
before.
Happening quicker than we think. Okay.
All the time, which might contribute towards the new energy that Ginger has on stage. Like, we are finally, never mind, like, getting old and some health issues here and there and geographical issues that we have. I'm like, guys, you know how lucky we are to be feeling amped to get on stage to belt out these old songs. Doesn't really matter, but with the fervor of a teenager. And so even just us being able to just drive down the road and come chat with me, I'm like, sheesh, bro, I hope there's not going to come a time when we're going to go, wow, remember when that was a possibility?
No one wants to talk. Later on, no talking and no eating.
Yeah, <bro.
laughs> it's just nothing.
Yeah,
I'm just going to plug myself into the matrix and eat a piece of digital fruit.
Digital smarty.
I'm sorry. I'm Keith Richardsing myself here.
Yeah, brother. So anyway, any more questions?
You
can talk as long as you want. We're not rapping. I'm just saying. Cool.
I think that's it.
Yeah.
I think we covered everything that I needed to cover. And
apart from the whole downer part at the end of the
Bava. The last 10 minutes.
That's not quite what you had in mind.
So what do you think of AI?
I think we're doomed.
We should take over everything and we'll all die.
Yeah. Okay, great. So you reckon albums aren't a thing anymore? Yeah. So you say more of a singles market.
So you say if you want a future in music, you should stop. Yeah, well. Just don't. You know what I thought? What I want to do is I want to sell wood. Because you don't get any comebacks.
That is true.
You people buy the wood, they go burn it.
Yeah.
If it was shit wood, they can't come back with the shit burnt wood and go like, crap. This is a piece of shit.
Bro, that's it. That's what we're doing.
I'm gonna fucking get a wood place and just sell people wood.
Bro, it's not a bad idea.
I'm just gonna sell briarwood for the rest of my life. That's it.
But I think you should carry on producing.
In case the wood business
burns out.
Yeah.
Oh man.
But think about it. It's the ultimate thing.
What wood?
Yeah, because you
see what our Instagram still. Hello, three people. It's my mom and you.
Oh, that's cool.
Lekker yellow.
Ach, man.
Just so you guys can get a view of how it looks in the studio. Go for my one look immense.
Yeah, thanks.
No, it's in the dark. Yeah, see, but dungeon is dark when it's load shedding, eh?
Yes, bro.
Do you feel scared?
I do feel. I mean, it looks like. I would really get some stuff here that you can chain someone to.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Somebody, we're going to cut to a commercial break.
For entertainment purposes.
And of course. Bye, everyone. Instagram, say bye.
Bye, Instagrams.
Thank you, Allah. Thanks for indulging our crap and for the love and support and all those beautiful things. Have a lucky evening. Are you sure you want to end? Yes.
Sure.
Yes.
I can't think of a better thing. I think that's the best idea I've ever had. Because I see this when I go surfing in Melkbos, there's this oak that sells wood on the side of the road, and there's always wood.
Yeah.
And there's always people just picking up wood. And he always has wood. Sometimes he's got less. And then when it rains, he takes the bottom ones because they're dry. But no one, I've never seen someone go back to him and go, like, this is a piece of shit wood.
That was crap.
No. No.
So are you here to tell people that you are actually, this is the end of your production thing. You are going into wood. Theo, what would you call it? Crass logs.
Sauerkraut.
Open a German restaurant and you serve it with a side of sauerkraut.
Sauerkraut.
Okay, now we're talking cut. Guys, we're going to go. Everyone say, let's just wave there into the camera that's not going off anymore. Theo Crous, the bloody legendary guitarist and producer extraordinaire and friend of mine. I'm so privileged to say, now that there's not such fierce competition over whose cassette is mastered or not.
Yeah, sure.
So I appreciate you, bro. Thanks for pulling in. I hope you enjoyed the steak dinner.
Yes, it was awesome. Yeah, awesome. Thank you.
Anytime. Thank you, everyone, for tuning in. If you can, try and share it. If you're on YouTube, please do subscribe. I'm trying to up that now that we are living in a streaming world. So please subscribe on there and do the liking and the sharing thing. And also, if you don't want to, don't do any of it.
Everything's
also very lekker, and you will be fine. All the crack you're going through right now, it's going to be fine. Trust me, you're actually already in the place that you need to be. That's all I can say. Good night. Love you lots. Cheers. Speak soon. Bye.